Okay. It is December 8th, 2012, and we're taping. Papa is going to tell us some stories. And go in and say hi, Becca. It's hi. Becca. That wasn't a great picture. Get back in there. Say hi, Becca.
Hi.
So Dad's going to tell, Papa's going to tell us some stories about his life. So why don't you start with when you were born, where you were born, and the whole mishpacha.
No,
go ahead.
Okay. A few years ago, Amanda bought me a book. It was called How to Write a Family History. I read a few chapters, but I never followed through. Now that I'm here visiting while Joanne is in the hospital and recuperating, she has convinced me to try to do it orally. Before I start, I want to just be sure everybody understands the ground rules. I'm going to do this from memory. I don't have any notes. I'm going to give my best recollection of our family history. It'll mostly be about my father's history, my father's family, because I don't know a lot about my mother's family. But I know some things, and I'll include whatever I can. I'm going to start at what is probably a logical beginning. My father came to the United States from Hungary to Ellis Island.
Is this too loud, you think?
I'm sorry?
Wait, I'm going to pause a minute. Do you think you can hear the latkes cooking?
I don't know.
Okay, go ahead.
I don't.
He came
to Ellis Island from Hungary on the 6th of June, 1906.
What boat?
Right.
Do you know which boat?
I have a paper someplace in the house that says what boat, but I don't remember the name of it.
Okay.
I know he came from Hamburg in Germany, and how he got from Hungary to Germany, I have no idea. He came with his brother, Nazi, who later became his business partner. They were, Nazi was a little older than my father, and my father accompanied, they came together in any case. His oldest brother was already in the United States, and I'm not sure how many of his brothers and sisters were already here, but eventually all 10 of the Spitz family, that is the children of Sarah and Joseph, came to the United States and mostly settled in New York. In fact, all of them settled in New York State, some of them in Brooklyn, and some of them in Schenectady. And my closest recollections are of the group who settled in Brooklyn, and I'll get to that. So he had 9 siblings, 3 of which were girls and 7 boys.
Do you remember all their names?
Yes, I know their names, but I'm not going to go through that.
Just quickly, tell me 10 names. Samuel, who's your father, who are the rest?
Nazi, Eugene, who was his next older brother. I'll
okay.
remember them
go ahead.
As we go.
Okay.
He had a sister, Fanny. He had a sister, Rose.
His parents didn't come then. His parents stayed in Europe.
No, they eventually all ended up in the United States, including my grandparents, who I didn't know, because they both died before I was born. But my mother, Jette Reichler, came also to New York from Poland. The circumstances of her emigration was that her oldest sister was supposed to come, but she had a boyfriend and was reluctant to leave him behind. And my mother came as a substitute because they already had a ticket for her sister. She came with a cousin of hers. And they also came to Ellis Island, I believe, around 1908, but I'm not really certain when my mother came. They got married after meeting in Manhattan. They both lived on the Lower East Side of Manhattan. My mother was a sewing machine operator. And I'm not sure what my father was doing at the time, but they got married in 1915, I believe. I can verify that because I remember that they had a 50th anniversary, and the memento from that anniversary is on my bedroom table. And it has the date of the 50th anniversary, but I think it was 1965 when we had the party for the 50th anniversary. So they were born, they were married in 1915. They had their first child in 1916, my sister Sarah, who was called Suki.
Tell me if you want me to stop.
What?
Tell me if you ever want me to stop and pause.
No, you don't have to stop.
Okay.
If I cry, it's okay.
It's okay.
Two years later, in, no, I guess it was, yes, in 1917, 1 year later, they had a second child, my sister Annie, and that was fortuitous because at the outbreak of World War I, they were drafting people for the army, and they weren't drafting married people with children. And my father already had two children in 1917. So, no, he already had one child. Annie was born in 1918. I made a mistake. Anyway, Suki was born in 1916, and he was a married man with children, so he didn't get drafted. I understand that in 1917, he moved the family to Detroit, and he went into the grocery business, which he was a failure at, I'm sorry to say. And after Annie was born in 1918, they returned to New York. With as little money as was available at that time. And they moved into an apartment in Brooklyn. And I'm not sure what my father was doing at that instant in time, but very shortly thereafter, he started a business with his brother, who had come to the United States with him as a tailor. And he was the cutter, and my uncle Nazi was the presser in the shop. In 1920, my sister Faye was born, and they had three daughters. In 1921, I guess they were getting desperate because my mother was pregnant again, and she had a boy who they named Morris. Later became Mal. My brother Mal, I'll have more to say about him later. In 1923, they had another daughter, Irene, Ida, who I always called Ida, but she preferred to be called Irene. But I never was able to do that. Call her Irene, that is. In 1926, my sister Bee was born.
What happened to Tati?
Tati was born in 1927.
Yeah. Before
Aunt B? No.
After
Aunt B?
I thought
Aunt B
was before.
No. After Aunt B. And by that time they had five girls and two boys, and I guess they decided not to have any more children. But I guess there was an accident, and I was conceived. And I was born in 1933, 6 years after my brother, Tati, whose real name is Irving. So now we're up to the fact that I came into the world. I don't have personal recollection of these things, but from stories that I heard, we had a pet. My sister Faye was very fond of, and it was a Spitz dog of the breed Spitz. I don't think he was a full-bred animal, but it was mostly a Spitz dog. And his name was Dickie, and she was very fond of him. My sister Faye, that is. And he used to sleep under her bed. Now, at this time, when I was born, and when my brother Tati was born, and when my sisters were born, we were living in an apartment in Brooklyn on Bobby Street between Sutter Avenue and Belmont Avenue. It was a cold water flat. That meant that there was no central heating. We had a bathroom in the apartment. The heat was provided by a coal-burning or wood-burning stove in the kitchen, which provided as best that it could, heat for the entire apartment. It was a three-bedroom apartment. And how all the girls and boys slept, I know I slept in my mother's room for a while. for some time, I'm sure, but I was too young to remember. And that's where we resided in Brooklyn. My mother, as was the custom in Eastern Europe at the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century, did not go to school. And she never learned to read or to write. She did learn on her own how to add and subtract and do numbers, and she was very good at it. She had to manage a family of 10 people, that is, 8 children and my parents, on what I'm sure was not a lot of money, no matter whether the 20s were roaring or not. And by the 30s, we were already in a deep depression, as everybody knows. The Great Depression started in 1930 and didn't really end until the war in 1941. But anyway, she managed during that time to keep the family together, keep us fed and clothed, and as it turned out, I'll get to that later, to be able to have all of her children go to high school, and as they graduated from high school, they went to work. None of them could afford to go to college during the Depression. They needed as much income as they could get. My sister Suki worked as a clerk in a cleaning store called Rio's, I remember. And she met a friend there named Henny, and Henny was her lifelong friend, Manon. And in fact, her sister, whose name was Henny's sister, married my cousin Irving, who was my uncle Eugene's oldest son. So there was a bit of family getting together even at that early time. In 1936, my parents managed to buy a two-family house in the same neighborhood of Brooklyn, that is East New York, which is a neighborhood at the end of the IRT line, the number 3 train, I believe it was, on the border of Queens. It's the eastern end of Brooklyn, southeast Brooklyn. And we moved into a two-family house, which was on a street called Linwood Street. And that's where I really grew up. When we lived on Barbie Street, I was really too young to know a hell of a lot. But when we moved to this two-family house, which was a row house attached on both sides for, I don't know, maybe 10 houses in a row. We lived upstairs and we rented the downstairs apartment. And the person who gave my father the mortgage was a lawyer who was the owner of the tenement that, we had lived on Bobby Street. My mother had taken on the role of superintendent of that building. That is, she collected the rents, she turned on the glass, the gas light in the hallways by putting a penny in the slot to light the stairways, but there was no electricity in the hall. We had electricity in our apartment, but not in the hallways. And we lived on the third floor on Bobby Street. And my mother, being close to Mr. Garvey, who was the lawyer who owned that building, he was willing to give my father the mortgage, and my mother continued to be the his agent for that building. So I used to accompany her every day to the Bobby Street building to light the gas light in the hallways and collect the rents and do whatever else she had to do as the building superintendent. On our block on Linwood Street were several, I don't want to call it unique, but it was a neighborhood and a street that I found very conducive to growing up in that area of the world. We had my next door neighbor, the man who owned the house next door, was an Italian man, Mr. Falco. I don't know what he did for a living, but he used to come and play rummy with my father every night after supper. The house next to Mr. Falco was a black family from the Caribbean, the Trimminghams, and they had two sons and a daughter. The daughter was about 2 years older than me. The next son was the same age as my brother, Patty, and the older one was about Mal's age. And he was the first person I knew, that is, the oldest Birmingham boy. I'm forgetting his name right now, but I'll remember it later, who had a motorcycle. He had a Harley Davidson that he kept in the cellar of his house, and he used to bring up the steps. I'll try to describe the configuration of the house in a few minutes. He was the first person I knew who owned a motorcycle. And across the street, there were not two family houses, but low-rise tenements, one of whose residents were the Zuckerbraus, whose second oldest son became my brother-in-law when he married my sister Ida in 1942. just at the time that we entered the war. Down the street towards Sutter Avenue, we lived on the block between Belmont and Sutter, which was south of Sutter Avenue, whereas on Bobby Street we had lived north of Sutter Avenue. Lived a another family, the Levines, whose, I guess he was the youngest son. His name was Aaron, but everybody called him Chippy, who also became my brother-in-law when he married my sister Faye, also in 1942, as he was about to be drafted. So we had, within this one block, two of my sisters married people on the block. I'll get to my brother Mel in a few moments. And down the street, also on Linwood Street, on the other side of Sutter Avenue, my father's brother, Eugene, called Janosch, lived with his family, and they were, I'm trying to remember how many, they were four sisters and one brother. So I had a lot of cousins within one block. My youngest uncle, my uncle Irving, lived about three blocks away on Ashford Street, and he owned he was the proprietor of a cleaning store. It seemed to be the family business to being either in the cleaning business or in the tailoring business. It all had to do with clothing and soft goods. I don't know how they got to that, but they were all farmers in Hungary. So they did whatever they could find. My brother Mal graduated from high school. They all my sisters and brothers, other than me and my brother Toddy, went to the local high school, which was Thomas Jefferson High School. Suki had graduated from that school. My sister Annie had graduated from that school. My sister Faye had graduated, and so on. My brother Toddy went to high school at the New York School of Printing to learn the trade of being a printer. And I went to Brooklyn Technical High School, which was a specialized high school in Brooklyn that required that you have certain qualifications for entrance, and I'll get to that also later. But my brother Mal, when he graduated from high school, it was the height of the Depression, and the first summer that he after high school, he got a job as a ice cream vendor for, I guess it was the most popular ice cream at the time. And he had a bicycle-driven cart that he would wheel around and sell. What the hell is that? They still sell it.
Good Yuma,
exactly. Yeah. Man, I remember the name. good humor, and he was a good humor vendor, because that was the only job he could find, but it didn't last long, and it lasted until the end of the summer. And since they didn't need people pushing bicycles or driven vending trucks in the winter, he was laid off and couldn't find a job, and he joined the army. That was the best job he could find. So he joined the army in 1939, and was on active duty at the time of Pearl Harbor, and he was stationed in, after training and so on, he had been sent to Iceland, where the army was installing the very early radar installations on a extinct volcano on the island of Iceland. So he was there, and in that, also in 1939, my sister Suki, who was the oldest, got married to Alex Rodkin, and he lived on the corner of Sutter Avenue, on Sutter Avenue, and Bobby Street, and that's where Suki met him. And he was the most handsome fellow I ever saw at that time, and she fell in love with him, and they got married in a ceremony that took place at the Temple Israel on Eastern Parkway, which was a Reform congregation. I don't know why we went there, but obviously it had something to do with the cost. And I was 6 years old at the time, and I remember the ceremony very well. I was sitting in the balcony of this Reform congregation. It was a huge auditorium. And a couple of my cousins were playing cards in the balcony during the ceremony. Anyway, they got married, and Al was too old. He was already past 30. They weren't drafting people of that age at that time. And by the time they got around to him, they had a child, my oldest niece, named Janie, in 1942. And I was only 9 years old when she was born. And my brother Mal, who was, as I said, was stationed in Iceland, sent home a bunting from a sheep bunting from Iceland for the new baby, for his oldest niece and our oldest niece. So now I'm up to the time when there are all kinds of ancillary stories that went on in between, but eventually my brother-in-law Buddy joined the Navy to avoid going to the Army. My brother-in-law Chippy got drafted and went to the Army and was stationed in Australia. Buddy was on a destroyer stationed in Trinidad, where their responsibility was maintaining destroyers and submarine stations, because the Germans had been torpedoing shipping up and down the east coast of the United States from early in 1942, shortly after the war started in December of 41. He was stationed in Trinidad for the whole time he was in the Navy until he came home and had his buddy, Zuccara, until he came home in 1944. I guess it was 44, maybe 45, I'm not sure. That I'm not sure. I think that Chippy also came home from Australia at the end of 1944. And I remember his homecoming because when he came home, he took the subway to Brooklyn, and I was waiting at the stairs, and when he came down the steps from the L, which was ran on Pitkin Avenue, that was the BMT, the Brooklyn Manhattan Transit. And I was there to greet him, but he wasn't too interested in me. He was looking for my sister Faye, and they soon got together and he was still stationed in the Washington area when President Roosevelt died. Now, President Roosevelt had been inaugurated President of the United States 2 months before I was born. And he died early in 1945 when I was just turning 12. Just before I turned 12. So the entire life that I had existed, he was the only president of the United States I ever knew. And it was a bit strange when Truman succeeded to the presidency. I remember the day he died because I was working for my father and delivering some goods to be hand-sewn to a seamstress who lived in another section of Brooklyn, and I was riding on a bicycle to deliver the material to this seamstress, and people were shouting out the windows that the president was dead. And at first I didn't understand what they were talking about, but I soon learned that that was the fact, that Roosevelt had died. And I was on my bicycle going to deliver these goods. Okay. So now I'm getting to when I graduated from public school, which was PS 158 in Brooklyn. And the only reason I'm pointing that out is that later in my life, Joanne, my wife, ended up teaching at that same school. And she actually met some, at least one of the teachers that I had when I was a student at that school, Mrs. Schweimer, who was my fifth and sixth grade teacher. And she remembered me because I was a smart kid and easy for her. I didn't cause her any trouble. So she remembered me. A few reminders about what went on during the war. During the war, there was air raid warnings. We had civilian patrols. And if there was ever an air raid warning, which were mostly drills, we never got bombed. If they sent us home from school, you had to go home with someone from an upper grade. So when I was in the fourth grade during the war, in 1939 I was in the first grade, 1938 I was in the kindergarten, 1940 in the second grade, and 1942 I was already in the third grade. I used to come home with the daughter of my neighbor, the black girl named Nan Trimingham.
Did you talk about your dad's victory garden and the grapevines?
Not yet.
Okay.
Amanda just asked about the victory garden. During the war, we had a small backyard. The only way to get to the backyard was to go through our basement and up stairs to get back to a grade level. And we had in our basement a coal bin, which provided fuel for a coal-burning stove that had to be fed during the day and damped down during the night, which supplied heat and hot water. So my father did that mostly because I was too young. Toddy was just being able to do some of it. And Mal was off in the army. In this backyard, every spring, we would have horse manure delivered,
and talk about the turtle.
What?
Talk about the turtle.
The turtle. Well, I'll get to the turtle. And we had to till the ground in the backyard, carry the manure through the basement up into the backyard, and spread it out as fertilizer for the victory garden, for the garden that we planted vegetables. Also in our backyard, we had a fig tree and a grapevine. And the grapevine climbed a trellis it was green grapes that my father used to make a kind of home fermented wine. that he concocted from a recipe he had from his father, I guess, from Hungary. So it's kind of like Tokay wine, I guess. They were green grapes, but we used all of the pulp and the skins, and it was kind of a rosé by the time it fermented. I didn't drink it, so I don't know how it tasted. I was a little kid. but somehow, we had a land turtle, and that man that talked about, that lived in our backyard and thrived on the vegetables, on the leaves of the vegetables that he found in the yard during the spring and summer and fall. And as it got to be, it was a land turtle, there was no doubt about that. But during the winter, it must have hibernated under the ground somewhere in our backyard. He dug himself a resting place and rode out the winter in that burrow, covered over with earth and snow and whatever occurred. And he appeared back the next spring, and for many years until we finally didn't see him anymore, and I guess he died, I don't know. I don't know what happened then. Oh, her. There was no other turtle present, so I don't, you know, he didn't propagate or she didn't propagate. I don't know whether it was a male or a female. In any case, I enjoyed that turtle. It was a lot of fun to watch. In 1945, I went to a new school, PS64, which was the junior high school that my brother Tari had gone to. And it was a school that it was more of a vocational kind of school, where they had different kinds of shops, like print shop, where Tari got the idea he wanted to be a printer. And there was a sheet metal shop, there was a electrical shop, there was a woodworking shop, and I learned to use all kinds of tools and built a lamp, both in the sheet metal shop. We built a conical lamp, and when I got into the electrical shop, we wired it up and it became a lamp, and it was a working lamp. While I was at the PS64, or Junior High School 64, it was called Benjamin Junior High School number 64, I met a group of boys in my class, which was a rapid advance class. We did 2 years of study in a year and a half. Two of whom, who became lasting friends of mine to this day. My friend Arthur Friedman was one of them. Alan Davis was another one of them. Marvin Hillman was probably, at that time, my closest friend. When I got married, he was a usher at the wedding, as was Arthur Friedman and Alan Davis, and Eugene Davidovsky. They were all ushers at my wedding, but Marvin signed the ketubah as a witness. He wasn't a religious person at all, and signed in English and not in Hebrew, as the rabbi would have preferred, but in any case, he was a witness. As it turned out, Marvin went to the same high school I went to. He went to Brooklyn with an E. Arthur Friedman went to a school called Boys High, which was obviously an all-boys school, and as was Brooklyn Tech, an all-boys school at that time. Now there are no single-sex high schools, to my knowledge, and the school that Arthur went to is a boys and girls high school, and Brooklyn Tech is a co-ed school at this time. But then it was single-sex. When we graduated from high school, Marvin went to the same college that I went to. He studied civil engineering as I did, so we were classmates. And we would, that's one of the reasons why he was the one that and we were in the ROTC together and got commissioned as second lieutenants in January of 1955. We started high school in January of 1951 and graduated in January of 55. We went to the Army together at the same time. I was posted to Fort Sheridan in Illinois. It was a suburb of Chicago, and he was posted to San Francisco at the Presidio of San Francisco, both in the Corps of Engineers. He was and I was. I met Joanne Korotkin, who became my wife, in the lunchroom at CCNY, where I went to high school.
College.
Thank you.
We went to college.
And before I graduated from college, in the winter of 1954, I proposed marriage, and she agreed, and we scheduled our wedding for July of 1955. As it turned out, I was called to active duty in the Army in March of 1955, and as I say, went to basic training, basic officer training at Fort Belvoir, Virginia, for let's see, March, April, May. I guess it was 4 months, June, it was 4 months of training before we got posted. So I had just completed my basic officer training class, and we had to schedule our wedding for Sunday night, July 3rd, because I was scheduled to be at Fort Sheridan, Illinois, sometime in the first week of July. So we scheduled the wedding for the 3rd, and we had a great wedding. At that time, the big pop star was a guy named Johnny Ray, who had a hit record called Cry that was all the rage amongst the teenagers and young adults. And as part of the entertainment for our wedding, there was a Johnny Ray would-be impersonator who sang all of his songs, including Cry, and everybody was very impressed by the performance. It was very good. Anyway, we got married. My brother Tati was my best man.
Did you talk about Sheila dancing at the bar mitzvah?
No, I didn't. Not yet. And Joanne's sister Sheila was the maid of honor. So Tati and Sheila were a couple. They were both single. Sheila was a student at CCNY, where we had both gone to school. Earlier, before the wedding, before Sheila started college, we had been invited to a bar mitzvah of Joanne's cousin, Stephen Platt. And the reason that Amanda wanted me to tell the story is that at the bar mitzvah, unbeknownst to anyone other than Joanne's mother, Tessie, and Sheila, they had arranged that Sheila, who was I shouldn't say school, but had been taking ballet lessons for many years as a child at Carnegie Hall. Every Saturday morning, her mother took her to Carnegie Hall for her ballet lesson. And at this bar mitzvah, she danced the dance of the sugar plum fairy from the Nutcracker. And whenever I remind Sheila of that performance, she cringes because she was not the most, she was very good as a, but she was not a talented ballerina. But she did the best she could, and we all applauded. Of course, it was the right thing to do. But she was only a kid at the time. I mean, maybe she was 17, I don't think, maybe not quite 17, because it was before she graduated, she went to college. how should I continue? I get diverted. I could go on for a while about all kinds of stories, but once we were married, Joanne and I, and you'll have to get the history of her family from Joanne directly. I don't really know a lot other than what happened after I met her and we were married. I know she had uncles and aunts who were very good to us. Her mother had been a widow since 1936, when her father died of congestive heart failure. He had been ill, I guess, and Tessie was a single mother for many years until she remarried long after we were married, that is, Joanne and I. So we got married on July 3rd, 1955, and set out in a car that we bought from a friend of one of Joanne's uncles, who was a used car salesman, and that should tell you everything you need to know. And I purchased it with the proceeds of an insurance policy that my mother had been paying for since I was born. She paid 25 cents a week to a insurance company. The guy came around and collected the 25 cents every week. And by the time I was 21, the policy matured for $500. And I took that $500, which was my wedding gift from my mother, and bought a car. I bought this 1951 Buick, which turned out to be, if not a disaster, not the greatest buy in the world. It didn't last long. Anyway, we had this car, and the day after the wedding, we stayed our wedding night at a hotel in Manhattan called the Essex House, which was on Central Park West, overlooking the park. But we didn't get there till late at night, on Sunday night. The next day was July 4th. We packed up our rented clothes, and I guess Joanne's wedding dress, I don't know where she got it, but she borrowed it from somebody. I'm not sure who. We packed it all up and took the subway home. My car was parked at my parents' house, where we had all our belongings. And we left on the, I guess it was the afternoon of July 4th, headed for Chicago. Now, this is a funny story, I'm going to tell you now. We stopped someplace in Pennsylvania, just off the Pennsylvania Turnpike. The Pennsylvania Turnpike was in existence at that time. There was no New Jersey Turnpike. There was no interstate parkway. And we went west on the on the Pennsylvania Turnpike, got off and stayed the night in some town in Pennsylvania. I don't even remember the name of that town. And when we got there, I discovered that I was out of cigarettes. So I told Joanne that I was going to go down the road and find a store where I could buy some cigarettes, and that we'd be back in 15 minutes or however long. But it turned out that I had to drive, I don't know, maybe 10 miles or so, or further till I found a gas station with a store attached. And I bought the cigarettes, and I came back to the hotel, to the motel, and Joanne was in the room, in the motel room, and apparently she fell asleep. And I'm knocking on the door, and I don't hear, she's not getting up. And I'm starting to panic. I don't know what to do. Now, I have a wife of one day. She's 20 years old. I'm 22 years old at that time. And I can't get into the room. So I go over to the desk in the motel, and I say, "Do you have another key?" My wife is locked in the room, and I can't awaken her. I don't know. So he asks me, "Is it possible she had a heart attack?" I say, "I don't know. We've only been married one day. I don't think so. I want you to have a heart attack." So he found another key for the room, and he opened the door. And I woke her up, and she was just exhausted from the wedding the day before. But I thought it was funny that this guy wanted to know whether she had any illnesses, and I said, "I haven't the faintest idea." Anyway, that was a funny story. We got to Illinois on the fifth or the sixth of July, and Fort Sheridan was a military post on Lake Michigan, and had a beach, an officer's beach, enlisted man's beach. There was separation not by race but by rank, and we went to the beach. And now I'm married maybe 3 days, and I got such a bad sunburn, and I should have known better because of my skin was fair, and I couldn't move, and I had to go to work. I had to report for duty, and it was the summertime, and I had to wear a khaki uniform, which was starched, and I couldn't get up. I couldn't get dressed, and Joanne had to help me on with my pants and with my shirt and button my buttons and tie my tie. And I walked into the commanding officer's office, and he looked at me, and I had a red face, and I was totally sunburned. And I said, Lieutenant Spitz reporting for duty, sir. And he laughed. He couldn't stop laughing. And he said to me, young man, he was a captain at the time. I don't remember his name. He said, I suggest you go home or back to wherever you're staying. And we were staying in the officer's guest house. And when you're able to perform your duties, you come back and see me. So I went back to the room at the officer's guest house, and we put the Vaseline and warm compresses on all of my behind my knees, so I could bend my knees. And it took me about two or three days to recover from the sunburn. And that's the way our married life started. And it was, although not unpleasant, but in some ways painful. We then went and looked for a place to live, because they had no, they didn't have sufficient officers' quarters on the base for us to be able to live on the post. So we went to the city of the closest town, which was a suburb of Chicago called El Cantony. I can't remember the name of the town now. And we found an apartment. We found a room. It was a studio apartment, one room with the cooking utensils on the wall, over an ice cream parlor in Hyde Park, is the name of the town, Hyde Park, Michigan. And we bought a convertible sofa that we opened that night to sleep on, and we bought a table and chairs for as a kitchen table, dining table, whatever kind of table you want to call it. And we spent as little as we could to furnish that apartment. And we stayed in that apartment until the end of, I guess it was October or November of 1955. That fall, in September or October, whenever the high holidays were, I put on my dress uniform and went to the local congregation, which was a conservative congregation. We had been attendees, that is, my family had been attendees of a conservative congregation when we moved to Flatbush after we left East New York. I skipped that whole era. I drove up and asked them if I could get tickets for the high holidays. and they were very accommodating, and they didn't charge us anything, and they gave us tickets right next to the Beamer, because I was a military person, and I guess there were not too many people at the post that were Jewish. I don't know how many they were. Anyway, when it came time for the first services, we walked about, I guess about a mile, or maybe three quarters of a mile, to the shul. And as we entered the shul, we saw all these people driving up and parking their cars in the parking lot of the shul. And that's something that I had never experienced, because we always lived within walking distance of the congregation, whatever it was, and we never drove on Rosh Hashanah or Yom Kippur or on Shabbos. Anyway, we attended the services, and they were very nice, and we walked home. The next day, I drove up to the shul like everybody else, and that was my first experience as a commuting conservative congregant. As I say, I was stationed there until I got orders to go to Korea. And if I was going to be in Korea, Joanne was not going to stay in our apartment in Chicago. So she decided to go home and go back to school, because she had not graduated yet. She still had a year and a half to go, I guess. Either 1 year or 2 years, I don't recall at this time. Anyway, I put her on a train, and she went back home to her mother, and re-enrolled at the CCNY, continue her education in education, as an education major. Well, before I shipped out to Korea, I got my orders were changed, and I was assigned to go to Fort Leonard Wood in Missouri as a member of the training cadre of the engineering training base, which was located there at at Fort Leonard. So I drove from Chicago, from Fort Sheridan to St. Louis. And on the way was my first mishap with this automobile that I had purchased. The windshield wiper on the driver's side flew off the car in the rain, and I had to drive the last 50 miles or so with my head out the window because I couldn't see out the windshield. I got to Fort Leonard Wood and was billeted at the bachelor officers' quarters, which was not a bad place to live if you weren't married. I I was, first time I ever had a bed to myself.
Tell me when you want to take a break.
Okay, I'll just finish this, this
okay.
story.
Okay.
About the being at the Fort Leonard Wood.
Oh yeah, go through that.
But at the end of the semester, Joanne said she would join me at Fort Leonard Wood. They also didn't have quarters for all the officers, married officers who were there, and I had to find living accommodations for us. And Joanne at that time was accustomed to taking baths as opposed to a shower. So I had to find accommodations with a bathtub rather than a stall shower. Now, I ended up renting a trailer that had a small bathtub and I didn't tell Joanne what kind of accommodations I had found, but when she came to Waynesville, which was the town adjacent to the army post, this was the first time she was on an airplane. She took a flight from New York to St. Louis. At St. Louis, she got on a bus and came to Waynesville. I picked her up at the bus stop in Waynesville and drove her to this location where there was a trailer in somebody's backyard. It was up on blocks. It was not didn't have any wheels. So it was not going anywhere. And she was introduced to life in a, I guess it was about a 27-foot trailer, which had a kitchen and a living room and a bedroom, and this small bathroom with a bathtub. And we lived in that trailer for several months until we found another trailer, which was a little bigger, and we moved into that trailer before we were assigned a house on the post. And I'm going to take a break now.
Okay.